So welcome to those who've joined the live stream. This is the morning service. Before you joined us, we heard from our mission link, the church in Hem in northern France. We remembered the bishops meeting at Lambeth, and we shared together the Nicene Creed, and we also sang of God's goodness. In a moment, we're going to turn to the ministry of the word, our Bible reading, and our sermon. But first, I have two bits of church family news that I want to share with you so that we can remember them in our prayers later on. The first concerns Isabel Jackson. A number of you will know that she's been ill for some time and been at home with her family. Isabel passed away peacefully at the end of this week, just a day or two back, and we trust that she is now in the arms of her Saviour. So we'll be remembering her family when we pray later on. The second bit of news concerns Jill and John Phillips, who this week, yesterday I think, celebrated Diamond, have I got this right? 60 years wedding anniversary, which is a remarkable achievement. And I'm sure if you ask, they'll give you details of their celebrations this week. But congratulations to you both. Okay, before we turn to our Bible reading, let me pray. Here is a collect from the prayer book, and it'll be familiar to a number. Blessed Lord, who caused all holy scriptures to be written for our learning, grant that we may in such a way hear them, read, mark, learn, and inwardly digest them, that by patience and comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and ever hold fast the blessed hope of everlasting life, which you have given us in our Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. I'll hand over to Bob, who will help us find our reading and then read it for us.
And the reading is from Ezra, chapter 9, and we'll read the whole of the chapter. So, verse 1. After these things had been done, the leaders came to me and said, "The people of Israel, including the priests and the Levites, have not kept themselves separate from the neighboring people with their detestable practices, like those of the Canaanites, Hittites, Perizzites, Jebusites, Ammonites, Moabites, Egyptians, and Amorites. They have taken some of their daughters as wives for themselves and their sons, and have mingled the holy race with the people around them. And the leaders and officials have led the way in this unfaithfulness." When I heard this, I tore my tunic and cloak, pulled hair from my head and beard, and sat down appalled. Then everyone who trembled at the words of the God of Israel gathered around me because of their unfaithfulness of the exiles. And I sat there appalled until the evening sacrifice. Then at the evening sacrifice, I rose from my self-abasement with my tunic and cloak torn and fell on my knees with my hands spread out to the God, the Lord my God, and prayed, "O my God, I am too ashamed and disgraced to lift my face to you, my God, because our sins are higher than our heads and our guilt has reached up to the heavens. From the days from the days of our forefathers, and now our guilt has been great. Because of our sins, we and our kings and the priests have been subjected to the sword and captivity, to pillage and humiliation at the hand of the foreign kings, as it is today."
Though we are slaves, our God has not forsaken us in our bondage. He's shown us kindness in the sight of the kings of Persia. He's granted us new life to rebuild the house of our God and repair its ruins, and has given us a wall of protection in Judah and Jerusalem. But now, our God, what can we say after this? For we have forsaken the commands you gave through your servants, the prophets, when you said, "The land you are entering to possess is a land polluted by the corruption of its peoples. By their detestable practices, they have filled it with their impurity from one end to the other. Therefore, do not give your daughters in marriage to their sons, or take their daughters for your sons. Do not seek a treaty of friendship with them at any time, that you may be strong and eat the good things of the land, and leave it to your children as an everlasting inheritance. What has happened to us is a result of our evil deeds and our great guilt. And yet, our God, you have punished us less than our sins have deserved, and have given us a remnant like this. Shall we then break your commands again, and intermarry with the people who commit such detestable practices? Would you not be angry enough with us to destroy us, leaving us no remnant or survivor? Lord God of Israel, you are righteous. We are left this day as a remnant. Here we are before you in our guilt, though because of it, not one of us can stand in your presence." Amen. Well, that's on page 481, which it'd be worth you having open as we look at that together. Let me pray and then we'll dive in. Heavenly Father, by your Spirit, you've given us these words. Please may he be the one who opens them to our minds and our hearts. We ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. Who's seen Paddington 2? It is a brilliant film, and I'm very glad that somebody recommended it to me. Most of the characters are lovely, apart from the obvious baddies, but there is someone who is a bit like Mr. Grumpy in what the children are looking at, and that is Mr. Curry, played by Peter Capaldi. Mr. Curry is basically Little England. He's the neighborhood watch on the street, and what he doesn't like is foreigners who've come over here and are living in our street. And if you remember, Paddington, despite his very nice English accent, is actually from Peru. And so Mr. Curry doesn't like him. Now, as we watch the film, immediately we identify with Paddington, and we really don't like Mr. Curry. In fact, we think there shouldn't be room for people like Mr. Curry in the street at all. I don't know how you felt as Ezra 9 was being read, but on the face of it, it sounds a bit the same. The problem is some of the exiles have married foreign women. They have, in the words of verse 2, mingled the holy race with the peoples around them. It all sounds, frankly, xenophobic and racist. It makes Mr. Curry from Paddington 2 seem like quite a nice person. What is going on? Well, you'll be reassured to hear that the Bible and this passage are not xenophobic, they're not racist. They are telling us something very important about God, and about sin, and about the nature of the Christian life. And we won't get to that message if we just respond with a knee jerk. We will get to it if we take the trouble to find out what is happening here and what is being said. So that's what we're going to try to do today. Today's task is to get to the bottom of the issue. And then next week we'll have a look at chapter 10 and have a look at how Ezra and his generation dealt with it and what we can learn from that. There just isn't time to do both of those things this morning. Let's start with where they are. And we've been looking at this part of the Bible is part of God's big story with his big relationship that he wants with people called a covenant. And it's summarized in this triangle. We have a triangle that the covenant offer is, "I will be your God and you will be my people." And there are three parties to the covenant: God, who makes the covenant; people on the bottom left-hand side, who are those who are invited into the covenant and then keep it by being faithful and obedient to God. Then there is a place where they can enjoy that covenant, because we're not disembodied souls, we are people. And so through its different forms all the way through the Bible, that's the covenant. I'll be your God, you'll be my people, there'll be a place where you can enjoy that. And we can see that Ezra and his generation, What they're doing is as that relationship has gone through ups and downs, they are part of a precarious restart after the disaster of the exile. And he summarizes in verse 7 of chapter 9. He says, from the days of our ancestors until now, our guilt has been great. They just haven't been obedient to God. Because of our sins, we and our kings and our priests have been subjected to the sword and captivity, to pillage and humiliation at the hand of foreign kings, as it is today. But now, for a brief moment, the Lord our God has been gracious in leaving us a remnant and giving us a firm place. And you'll see that the footnote says, a foothold in his sanctuary. And so our God gives light to our eyes and a little relief in our bondage. So Ezra is hanging on to this covenant, a little foothold. And so the sin that troubled Israel at this stage is not just that these people are foreign, it was their own unfaithfulness to God. The choice they faced was between honoring God and being different, or not honoring God and being like the other nations. And Ezra is so deeply saddened that this is what's happened all through history, and now the exiles are repeating that history. The very sin that led to exile in the first place, that they wanted to make a fresh start from, has not only crept in, it's been brought in. And in order to illustrate that, our attention is drawn to two periods in that history of Israel where God's people were called to be separate and didn't. And the first is mentioned in verse 1, where we have all these nations, the Canaanites, the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, the Ammonites, the Moabites, the Egyptians, and the Amorites. Now, for most of us, those are just kind of a bunch of foreign nations. But in Ezra's generation, those people no longer existed. It would be like me today talking about the Britons, the Angles, and the Saxons. You've heard of them, but you're not going to meet them today. So why does Ezra mention those nations which belong to the generation of Joshua when they came out of the Exodus and went into the land? Those are the people who were there. Well, that's because verse 11 says what they were told. The land you are entering to possess is a land polluted by the corruption of its peoples. By their detestable practices, they have filled it with their impurity from one end to the other. It's those nations that they are talking about. And their detestable practices began with idolatry. They were not worshipping the God of Israel, but it led to all kinds of awful things, including possibly child sacrifice. They're polluting the land. That is why it's important when there is this fresh start to be separate from them, verse 11. Therefore, don't give your daughters in marriage to their sons or take their daughters for your sons. Don't seek a treaty of friendship with them at any time, that you may be strong and eat the good things of the land and leave it to your children as an everlasting inheritance. Sadly, Israel did not follow through on that. They didn't keep separate, and therefore they didn't enjoy the blessings of the land that came with the covenant. And they didn't leave it to their children as an inheritance. They were taken away from it and into exile. All because of these sins which they should have kept away from and eradicated, they embraced. I think we can illustrate this with the idea of the volunteer potato. Now, real gardeners will just have to bear with me at this point. I got this from a YouTube video, so it's about all I know about gardening. But basically, the way to grow potatoes is great. You just plant a potato, and then the rest follows. I mean, potato is my best friend at the moment in terms of gardening. And as the plant grows, and then at the end of the season, when it's time to harvest them, you dig through the soil, and you're obviously trying to find the potatoes which are buried in the ground. A volunteer potato is one that is left behind in that process. It'll sit quite happily in the ground, and next year it'll go, hey, I'm a potato, it's time to grow. And out it comes. And you might think, that's a bonus. I can have next year's potatoes without having to do anything. Here's the rub. Potatoes are apparently subject to blight. So towards, I guess, the end of the season, if your potatoes have got blight, there's something you can do with it. But then you're harvesting your potatoes, you take them all out, but the volunteer potato has the blight in it. And so the next year you plant your new potatoes to start the new crop, but our friend the volunteer potato also grows with the blight and devastates your crop. That is why gardeners apparently do not like volunteer potatoes. They are a threat because they'll carry the blight into the following year. Well, if we think of the land of Canaan as our potato patch, the Canaanites, they are the blight, their detestable practices. And as the Israelites were to come in, marrying into those Canaanites was like saying to the blight, let's bring it on. And verse 13 explains, what has happened to us is a result of our evil deeds and our great guilt. And yet, our God, you have punished us less than our sins deserved and have given us a remnant like this. So this is not a racial thing, it's a spiritual thing. These nations were following their ways, and Israel was to be different. And if they marry into those peoples, they marry into those ways. And the evidence that it's about spiritual identity, not racial ancestry, is Rahab the Canaanite. You can read about her in Joshua chapter 2. She was a Canaanite, but she became an Israelite. More than that, she became an ancestor of Jesus. Racially, she was a Canaanite, but spiritually, her identity is to say, I belong to the God of Israel. She separated herself from those practices. She was not a volunteer potato. The second incident that's mentioned is from the life of Solomon. It's a little bit more subtle, but here's what we learn from 1 Kings chapter 11 about King Solomon. 1 Kings 11 verses 1 and 2. King Solomon, however, loved many foreign women besides Pharaoh's daughter, Moabites, Ammonites, Edomites, Sidonians, and Hittites. They were from the nations about which the Lord had told the Israelites, you must not intermarry with them, because they will surely turn your hearts after their gods. Nevertheless, Solomon held fast to them in love. And if you read on, you'll find that Solomon's wives turned his heart away from the God of Israel. Now, this particular phrase, foreign wives, which appears in 1 Kings 11, is used in Ezra chapter 10. You'll see it, I think, in verse 2. It only turns up in that passage about Solomon and this chapter in Ezra 10. So it is a technical term for these women who will draw their hearts away, because these women are fairly and squarely still located in their other religions. And so the foothold that God has given Ezra and his generation is about to be swept away by these foreign wives. Foreign wives being a term for those outside the covenant who will take their marriage partners with them. And again, the counterexample that this is not just about them being foreign, but about their spiritual commitment, is in the life of Ruth. Ruth is from Moab, one of the prohibited nations, yet she came to Israel and again was not just accepted into Israel, became one of Jesus' ancestors. But we see that she changed her commitments, because when she follows Naomi, she says this. This is Ruth chapter 1, verse 16. Ruth replied, don't urge me to leave you or to turn back from you. Where you go, I will go, and where you stay, I will stay. Your people will be my people, and your God, my God. So there is room for people from any background to come to commit themselves to God. But the issue with these foreign women is they remained committed to their gods. And for Ezra and his generation, this is the very thing they're trying to make a fresh start from. And if people have married there, it threatens that the fragile foothold they have on this fresh start. They stand to lose everything that God has given them through the covenant. Now, that's a long explanation, but I hope we've got to the bottom of what the issue is. Now I want to ask the question, what's equivalent for us as Christians? Because we're not rebuilding Jerusalem. What's the equivalent for us? Well, the first thing to say is the church is not a nation. So faithfulness or unfaithfulness have nothing to do with nationality or a national way of life or a race. The Christian church is a family drawn from every race and nation on the earth. Well, maybe the first parallel would be with mixed marriage in the New Testament. That seems the most obvious, and a number of commentators go there. That is marriage where the one person is a Christian and the other is not. Now, there are similarities, but I think there are significant differences. I think it's worth having a look at some of the New Testament passages so we see what is being said here. So let's go to 1 Corinthians, and Paul is addressing the situation in which in this church there are marriages in which one person is a Christian and the other isn't. But it happened because they were married first and then one became a Christian. This is 1 Corinthians chapter 7, verses 12 to 14. And just when he says, I, not the Lord, what he's saying is this question didn't arise directly in Jesus' teaching. So Jesus himself didn't pronounce on it. Paul is pronouncing, but he's pronouncing as an apostle. So this is not optional advice. This is a command to follow. He says to the rest, I say this, I, not the Lord, if any brother has a wife who is not a believer and she's willing to live with him, he must not divorce her. And if a woman has a husband who's not a believer and he's willing to live with her, she must not divorce him. For the unbelieving husband has been sanctified through his wife, and the unbelieving wife has been sanctified through her believing husband. Otherwise, your children would be unclean, but as it is, they are holy. You see, it's not quite the same situation as in Ezra, because in Corinth, these people were married first, and then one of them became a Christian. And Paul's saying, if that's your situation, stay married if you can. He even suggests that if your witness is faithful, you're somehow sanctifying the other party, which is very different from Ezra, because we'll see in chapter 10 what he tells them to do is to divorce these wives. So it's not quite the same. It's worth saying that later on, Paul makes clear that for a Christian deliberately to enter into a mixed marriage is wrong. Here's verse 39 of that same chapter. He says, a woman is bound to her husband as long as he lives, but if the husband dies, she's free to marry anyone she wishes, but he must belong to the Lord. So Christians should not enter into mixed marriages, but if you find yourself in one, there's no command to divorce from it in the way that we will see in Ezra. So why is it different? What's changed between the time of Ezra and the time of Christ? Well, let's think about what difference Jesus makes. Does what we've read mean that Jesus is not as concerned with sin as Ezra is? Is the New Testament more relaxed than the Old Testament? Well, I don't think so. If you remember our New Covenant triangle, we've got God and people and place. For Christians, God is the same God. People begins with Jesus. He is the one who has kept the covenant for us. And then all Christians, we find ourselves within him, the Christian church. Our place is not on this earth, it is the whole new creation. And here is a description of that whole new creation. This is from John's vision in Revelation. Revelation 21 from verse 22. Excuse me. I didn't see a temple in the city, because the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple. The city doesn't need the sun or the moon to shine on it, for the glory of the Lord gives it light, and the Lamb is its lamp. The nations will walk by its light, and the kings of the earth will bring their splendor into it. On no day will its gates ever be shut, for there will be no night there. The glory and honor of the nations will be brought into it. Nothing impure will ever enter it, nor will anyone who does what is shameful or deceitful, but only those whose names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Do you see that the new creation will succeed where every generation of Israelites failed? Because they failed, as it were, to root out the volunteer potato, or even they failed to stop themselves bringing it in. But in that new creation, none of that will be present. That's why in chapter 21, you remember, there is no more mourning or crying or tears or pain, because the old order of things has passed away. Or no volunteer potatoes will have their place in the new creation. It is uncompromisingly against sin, as the old covenant is, just successfully so. So the glory of the new covenant is that the believer's foothold in that new covenant doesn't depend on our obedience in the way that it would have done for Ezra. It depends on Jesus' obedience, and that is secure. So what it means for the Christian church is this. We are a community of people who have been called to belong to the new creation. Not because we have succeeded. Not because we have kept the law. not because we are better than others. Really, we're like Rahab the Canaanite. We started in the wrong place. We're like Ruth the Moabitess. We belonged to the wrong people. But we have been brought in by God's grace. And we've looked at 1 Corinthians chapter 7. In the previous chapter, Paul explains it like this. First, he reminds these believers that, as we saw will be the case in Revelation, the new creation will not have room for the sin that pollutes. Here's 1 Corinthians 6, verses 9 to 10. Do you not know that wrongdoers will not inherit the kingdom of God? Don't be deceived, neither the sexually immoral, nor idolaters, nor adulterers, nor men who have sex with men, nor thieves, nor the greedy, nor drunkards, nor slanderers, nor swindlers will inherit the kingdom of God. There will be no room for them. And he explains where believers fit in. That is what some of you were, but you were washed, you were sanctified, you were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. What he's saying is that if you're a believer, you did these things. We were all Canaanites. We're all volunteer potatoes. But by faith, you were washed. You were sanctified, made holy. You were justified in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ and by the Spirit of our God. And the logic of it is, if Jesus died to save you and to wash you from those things, why would you embrace them again? And then he says, if you're a believer, you've been saved by Jesus' death through the cross for citizenship in the new creation, that new city, where none of those things will have a place. And if they don't belong there, why should they have a place here in the life of our church? Why are we celebrating things that will have no place there and things that we've been saved from? Now, we could look at other passages in the New Testament and see the same. And in the notes, I was going to look at some other passages, but I've changed my mind. But I would have made very similar points. So I think the issue that matches us compared to the situation Ezra faced isn't so much mixed marriages, although there are reasons not to deliberately enter into one, but bringing into church the very things that the nations think is okay, but God has called us to be separate from. So I think if Ezra had been a Christian and he'd had this conversation in church, this is what verses 1 and 2 of chapter 9 would have sounded like. After these things had been done, the leaders came to me and said, the people, that is the Christians, including the priests and Levites, that is the leaders, have not kept themselves separate from the neighboring peoples with their detestable practices like those of the unbelievers. They've taken some of their practices for themselves and have mingled the people from all nations whom Jesus died to save with the people around them. In other words, we're not different from anybody else. And the leaders and officials have led the way in this unfaithfulness. If we're called to be Christian, we're called to be different. And if we're called to be different, it means we cannot affirm those things that others consider normal, but God has pronounced will not have a place in the new creation. If we do that, then we are repeating the sin of the exiles. There are some obvious practices that we could bring in and would be wrong to do so. The first would be worshipping other gods alongside our God. Now, we can be neighbours with people who worship other religions, and it is right to do that. But the Bible doesn't teach that we're all paths up the same mountain. We can't bring the worship of other gods into the worship of the God of the Bible. He is alone. We can't similarly live by the world's sexual standards. And I mention that because these are the big questions of the day. And we're caught in the tension between what the world considers normal and what is going to be normal in God's kingdom, fully seen in the new creation. But we can't embrace what Jesus died to save us from. But there are other sins listed, such as greed and swindling. Greed is mentioned often in the vice lists. Now, there's no excuse for these things. Now, again, we look out. There are good and generous people outside the church, absolutely. But it is acceptable, I think, outside the church to say, yes, you need to look after number one. But that's not a Christian way. So the moment we affirm the rightness of looking after number one and that greed is good, we've walked right into the volunteer potato. God calls us to be different, generous, humble, faithful. So faithful Christian living is affirming the values of the new creation. Well, you go, that's all very well, but you don't know what I'm like. I'm full of kind of unresolved sin. How am I supposed to hide? You're going to throw me out of the church? How's that going to work? How does it work when the church is made up of sinners, washed and sanctified, but still sinning despite our best efforts? Now, we will look at that next time, but here are some headlines. Let's go back to Mr. Curry. What was Mr. Curry's solution to the problem of Paddington? His solution to the problem of Paddington is to point the finger at Paddington and say the problem is him or them. He makes the problem other, and then you just need to remove the other person. But the Bible teaches us to say the problem is not them. The problem is you and me. It's an us problem. In a moment, we're going to sing a wonderful song which asks the question, do you feel the world is broken? And we reply, we do. You see, we see sin in ourselves, and if we do that, then we should respond like Ezra and those who trembled at the word of God. Verse 4, then everyone who trembled at the words of the God of Israel gathered around me because of this unfaithfulness of the exiles, and I sat there appalled until the evening sacrifice. When we see sin in ourselves and in our church, we can mourn it and then realize that our identity is not in our own goodness. Our identity is in Jesus Christ and his goodness. And just for an example, I've mentioned the Corinthian church. I mean, if you know it at all, I mean, it's an absolute basket case of a church. They are full of really odd characters and lots of problems. And yet the letter begins with this. Paul calls them those sanctified in Christ Jesus and called to be his holy people. He's saying they are holy not because they're good people. They're holy because they're in Christ. And you and I, if we're a forgiven sinner, then we are home. You're one of us. We're in it together. Now, next time we'll learn from Ezra as to how to deal with these issues. But today I just want to see that the issue is much bigger than mixed marriage. It's about the seriousness of sin. And before I pray, let me just finish by introducing my friend Christopher. Christopher, if you ever get to meet him, is a mild-mannered clergyman now working in the north of England. He's mild-mannered, except when it comes to garden pests. It was one of the most striking memories of him. We were in his garden, and he saw a pest underneath a plant. And he dived on it with a fury I've never seen. He is devoted to the destruction of pests and their removal. I just wish that we had the same attitude to sin. Ezra, I think, did. So we turn to pray. Here's a prayer from a book called The Valley of Vision. Blessed Spirit, author of all grace and comfort, come work repentance in my soul. Represent sin to me in its odious colors that I may hate it. Melt my heart by the majesty and mercy of God. Show me my ruined self and the help there is in him. Teach me to behold my Creator, his ability to save, his arms outstretched, his heart big for me. May I confide in his power and love. Commit my soul to him without reserve. Bear his image. Observe his laws. Pursue his service. And be through time and eternity a monument to the efficacy of his grace, a trophy of his victory. And make me willing to be saved in his way, perceiving nothing in myself but all in Jesus. Help me not only to receive him, but to walk in him, depend on him, commune with him, be conformed to him, follow him, imperfect but still pressing forward, not complaining of labor but valuing rest, not murmuring under trials but thankful for my state. And we pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Please have a seat. Isn't that an encouraging song? Well, we've thought about the nature of sin, and because God is gracious and compassionate, we don't need to hide our sin from him. He invites us to come to him. The Lord Jesus says, "Come to me, all who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest." And the way he's given us is through confession. So we're going to have the words of a confession prayer come up here, and I invite you to join me to come to God and seek his face and his mercy. Let's pray together. Lord God, we have sinned against you. We have done evil in your sight. We are sorry and repent. Have mercy on us according to your love. Wash away our wrongdoing and cleanse us from our sin. Renew a right spirit within us and restore to us the joy of your salvation through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. And here are some verses that remind us of God's promise. If we claim to be without sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, God is faithful and just and will forgive us our sins and purify us from all unrighteousness. Well, we're going to continue in prayer now with our intercessions, and I'm going to hand over to Tim to lead us.
Good morning, everyone. In our prayers today, we'll use some of the words of David in Psalm 25 and also from Paul's letter to the believers at Philippi. So let us pray together. And as we meet together as forgiven sinners here in St. George's and online, let us rejoice in the Lord always and again rejoice as we lift up our souls and hearts to you, O Lord, in whom we trust, our loving God. Thank you for meeting each one of us in our Saviour Jesus Christ, and we humbly pray that he who began a good work in us, whether recently or long ago or yet to come, will carry it on to completion until the day of the Lord comes again, or we are called home first. Please show us your ways, O Lord. Teach us your paths, that your love dwelling in us through the Spirit of truth may grow more and more in knowledge to discern what is best, and to produce in us the fruit of righteousness that comes only through knowing you, Jesus, to the glory and praise of God the Father. Amen. And so enable us, dear Lord, to look out for each other in godly love and service, to listen to the Spirit's prompting our hearts and minds, to show his gentleness to all, especially the lost and the hurting, those struggling to find meaning or just overwhelmed by poor health or the demands of daily life, and also the lonely and afflicted. Help us to show the reason for the hope you have placed in us through our friend and Saviour, Jesus, who died and rose again, that we should believe. Amen. Of course, we know both David and Paul in their days faced danger and troubles through persecution in serving our God. David often in hiding from his bitter enemies, and Paul many times in prison and in chains. So as many experience much concern and fear, as our world of 2022 indeed seems to be spiraling out of control, we turn to the Lord of peace and order, who alone can guard our lives and rescue those in life-taking and life-threatening situations. So once again, we turn to the East and we pray once more about the conflict in the Ukraine that breaks the hearts of all people of goodwill and justice in its brutality and unfairness. We pray indeed for an end to the fighting as soon as possible, but also for the almost now 14 million people displaced from their homes and livelihoods and having to go elsewhere for safety, wherever they can find it. We do thank God for all organisations, authorities and individuals providing safe refuge, security across Europe and in the UK, including here in Somerset. And also, as we'd heard recently, our brother in Christ, Valerica, in Romania. Likewise, we lift up in prayer Christian agencies and churches working in Ukraine and across Europe, including our mission partner, Open Doors, also Mission Without Borders, and the Bible Society, through whom many are finding hope in God's word. And we do give thanks for some good news for the resumption of grain and vegetable oil exports, and pray that this will continue safely and reach those in need around the world. And we pray too for de-escalation in the situation over Taiwan, that wise counsel and the dove of peace will prevail amongst and between China, the USA, and those nations at risk from any conflict. And we remember those who know and follow Jesus, our sisters and brothers in him. In many so-called peaceful and democratic countries, they're at growing risk of violence and persecution from their neighbours as nationalism increases and authorities seem unable or unwilling to protect them, especially Christians in the Indian subcontinent and the Middle East. Grant them your protection, O Lord. Amen. And locally, remember the work here with the Green Door families in our area, being helped by St. George's and others, giving thanks for those who support them with the love of Jesus. We do pray for more connectors to link such families with our team so that we can get alongside them. Amen. And we give thanks, O Lord, that despite living in this fallen and troubled world, you have shown us your great mercy and love, deep as the deepest ocean, loving and faithful in all your ways, and revealed most fully on Calvary, where Jesus took all the sins of humankind on himself and turned them into amazing grace. Grace enough for everyone of us here to share as a community where all things noble, pure, right, and lovely are to be valued. And so, in and through that grace that knows no limit, we commend our dear sister Isabel to you today, Lord. Now that we hear, she has been called home. We thank you for her long life of caring, service and friendship that many of us here shared part of with her. And we do pray today for her family as they mourn and miss her so much. May she indeed rest in peace and rise in glory. Amen. As we've heard today, we pray for our mission links, Christophe and Catherine, in M in France, and thank God for their great news today about the growth of their church and ministry there. And we're asked to remember also today all those from St. George's who are away, leading or guests at summer camps, that the good news of Jesus Christ will increase through their time of fellowship and fun together. And as we've also heard, we do rejoice today and give our prayerful thanks for the diamond anniversary of John and Jill Phillips' long marriage and wish them every blessing as they enjoy their ongoing celebrations of this happy event. And we finish our prayer time again in Paul's words by praising our God who exalted our Saviour to the highest place and gave him the name above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow and every tongue confess that he is Lord. Amen. Lord's Prayer. And we join together in the word of the Lord's Prayer on the screen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you, Tim. Let's join for our final hymn, which is When I Survey the Wondrous Cross. Let's stand to sing. Thank you. Well, in a moment, coffee, tea across the road. First, just a few notices. First of all, I have some bans of marriage to read. So, here we go. I publish the bans of marriage between Christian James Leeworthy and Deborah Emily Grundon, both of this parish, and also between Nathaniel James Lloyd of St. Mary's Carn and Lucy Ann Brett of St. Cuthbert's Brislington, and also between Joshua Ian Sturdy and Emily Michaela Franks, both of St. Francis Parish, Bridgewater. These are all for the first time of asking, and if any of you know any reason in law why these persons may not marry each other, you are to declare it now. Okay, through the first hurdle, well done. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, thank you for these couples, their desire to be married. We pray for them, for joy on their wedding day, and for a firm foundation in their marriage. May they find in Christ the sure foundation, and we ask it in his name. Amen. Just to say something about pick and mix, we've got a number of social occasions over the summer, and there are sign-up sheets. If they're not at the back of church, they'll be at coffee. It's a paper sign-up, but there's a walk or a tea or a board games or whatever. Do take the opportunity to meet people in that way. Also this week, or also this summer, we have a book which we're encouraging people to buy called Incomparable at the amazing price of £1, and there are some across the road. And if you want to dip into that book, and then we have a book club once a fortnight, and the next meeting is this Wednesday, we'll be looking at the second section. So all you have to do is have read one chapter in the second section, and you can bluff your way through. And the chapters are only 3 pages long. So for £1, it's a great way to grow in that way. I encourage you to do that. I think that's all. Let me finish with this closing prayer. This is from Paul's letter to the Ephesians. For this reason, I kneel before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth derives its name. I pray that out of his glorious riches he may strengthen you with power through his Spirit in your inner being, so that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith. And I pray that you, being rooted and established in love, may have power together with all the Lord's holy people to grasp how wide and long and high and deep is the love of Christ, and to know this love that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled to the measure of all the fullness of God. Amen. Thank you for your fellowship. Goodbye, and God bless.